Hello everyone, welcome to the THirD BeNCHERS YouTube channel. Today we'll see June 2016 Part A questions of CSIR Life Sciences paper. Question 1. An infinite number of identical circular disks, each of radius half, are tightly packed such that the centers of the disks are at integer values of coordinates x and y. Now, the ratio of the area of the uncovered patches to the total area is. So, from the given question, we have to find the ratio. Which are these? So, what is the ratio of the uncovered patches to that of the total area? Now, it is given that many number of identical circular disks are packed tightly. So, consider a space where many such circular disks are packed. Right? So, in these cases, what we see is, so let's consider our case with this circle. Now, around this circle, let's draw a square. Now, the area occupied, now what we're supposed to find is, this circular arrangement is continued both in the x and the y directions to an infinite number of distance. So, we have to find the ratio of the uncovered patches to that of the total area. That is, the total area could be a square or a rectangle, that is the entire area of the circles to which it is packed, to that of the total area of the uncovered patches. So, which is these regions, correct? So, these are the uncovered patches and these are the covered patches. So, we have to find the ratio. Now, let's consider it for one circle and then extrapolate to the entire region. Considering it for this circle, I'll zoom in this image. We see that, drawing circles to the sides. Now, let's draw a square closer to this circle. Now, these regions are the uncovered regions. So, for each circle, such regions are present. Now, in this region, this quarter corresponds to this circle, this quarter corresponds to this circle, this quarter to this circle, and this quarter to this circle. So, each of the circles have four quarters of parts of the square which are uncovered. So, when we find it for one circle, we can extrapolate to so many circles and the ratio will remain the same. Now, the radius of the circle is half, which means the side of the square is 1. So, area of square is a square, which is 1 square, is 1. Area of circle is pi r square, which is pi into 1 by 2 square, which is pi by 4. Now, area of the uncovered region is area of the square, uncovered patch, is area of square minus area of circle, which is 1 minus pi by 4. Now, the total area is the area of the square. So, total area of square, which is 1. Therefore, ratio is 1 minus pi by 4 by 1, which is 1 minus pi by 4. Option 1 is the correct answer. Moving on to the second question. It takes 5 days for a steamboat to travel from A to B along a river. It takes 7 days to return from B to A. How many days will it take for a raft to drift from A to B when all speeds stay constant? So here, they say that from A to B, it takes 5 days. And from B to A, it takes 7 days. So this means that this is downstream and this is upstream, since upstream takes more time than downstream. Now, we know that velocity is inversely proportional to time. So here, velocity is inversely proportional to the number of days. Now, downstream speed is the speed, this is a steamboat. So which means the boat also has a specific velocity. So VB plus VR, downstream, takes a time of 5 days. And upstream, which is VB minus VR, takes a time of 7 days. Now, taking the LCM and equating, we get 35B plus 35VR equal to 7 and 35VB minus 35VR equal to 5. Now, 70VB is 12. Now, the question asked is, how many days will it take for a raft to drift from A to B? Raft has no velocity on its own. So, VB for raft is 0. It drifts from A to B, which is very logical because it can only drift from downstream. For upstream, it needs to have an extra speed that competes with that of the speed of the river. So, for the raft to drift from A to B, we need to know VR. So since we know VR is 1 by 5 minus 12 by 70, which is 14 minus 12 by 70. 2 by 70, 1 by 35. Now VR is 1 by 35. So time taken is 35. It is 1 by V. Since we know that V is inversely proportional to time. So time taken is 35. So it takes 35 days for a raft to drift from A to B when all speeds stay constant. Now moving on to the third question. My friend Raju has more than 1,000 books, said Ram. So Ram says Raju has more than 1,000 books. Now, Shyam says, oh no, he has less than 1,000 books, which means and well, Geeta says, well, Raju certainly has at least one book. So Geeta says, Raju has at least one book, at least one. So from this, if only one of these statements is true, how many books does Raju have? It is given that only one of these statements are true. So, first considering the given options, we see that 0 is not one of the options. So, it is evident that Geeta is true. Now, to eliminate both these options, we need to have a value in between. One says less more than 1,000 and other says less than 1,000. So, none of them say 1,000. And Geeta says that it is more than one. So, from these given options, to have only one of the statements to be true, only 1,000 can satisfy all these three conditions. So, 1,000 is the correct answer. Next question. Of the following, which is the odd one out? Cone, torus, sphere and ellipsoid. Now, from the given options, we see that a cone is this kind of a shape. A torus is a donut shape. A sphere is a spheroid. An ellipsoid is an elliptical sphere. Okay, now there are different ways in which this can be considered. This question can be solved by in a subjective manner. Each of us can have a different opinion, and thus even the answer key has more than one answer to be correct. Now, considering the number of edges here, cone has one edge, torus has zero edge, sphere has zero edge, and ellipsoid has zero edge. So based on the number of edges, cone can be considered as the odd one out. Now, this is one of the methods. The other method by which this can be considered is, considering a sphere can be drawn into an ellipsoid, into a cone, but never into a torus. Here, in a layman's term, it is observed that torus is an incomplete solid, in a layman's term. And also, it is proven mathematically that a torus cannot be constructed back to a sphere. So, a torus is also an odd one out. So, one or two, cone or a torus. But while marking, don't mark both the options, as it may lead to disqualification of the answer. Now, the fifth question will be discussed later. Moving on to the sixth, find the next figure, D. Now, this is a very simple question. Now, considering these diagrams, we need to find what comes in the pattern next. So, here, let's start with the nature of the shape. Here, it is shaped in this direction, and here, it is shaped in this direction. Now, again, this is shaped in this direction. So, the next one, obviously, will be facing in this direction. Of these, only option 2 or option 3 could be the most suitable one. Now, considering the nature of the circle and the sphere, the shapes inside these patterns, first it is circle and circle, square and square. Similarly, this one has square on the top, and also this should also be having a square on the top and a circle at the bottom. The one that satisfies this option is option 2. Option 2 is the correct answer. Next question. A student appearing for an exam is declared to have failed the exam if his or her score is less than half the median score. This implies, which of the following does this situation imply? Now, first, a student appearing for an exam is declared to have failed the exam if his or her score is less than half the median score. So, by plotting the scores, we find that when a student scores less than half the median score, it would lie somewhere here. This would be the median. Less than half the score. So, students falling in this range are considered to have failed. Now, what does this situation imply? One quarter of the students appearing for the exam fails. This is wrong because here the median is with respect to the score and not with respect to students. So depending on the range of the marks, the number of students who pass or fail is different. And it cannot be compared directly with the score of the students. So 1/4 of the students appearing for the exam always fails is a wrong statement. Now, next to the next option. If a student scores less than 1/4 of the maximum score, he or she always fails. Here it says that when a student scores less than 1/4 of the maximum score, he or she always fails. Now to the third option, if a student scores more than half of the maximum score, he or she always passes. More than half of the maximum score, he or she always passes. Now these two appear to be correct options, like are potential candidates for being the correct option. However, there is a catch here. The median score. Here, the criteria for passing is evaluated based on the median score. Median is a positional average. Median is positional average, which means it can change. It is influenced by the nature and the distribution of the marks, the range of the marks that is being given. So say all the students get 100 and only one student gets 50. Now, here, based on this value, what is the median? 100 is the median, right? So here, when a student scores, here it is biased to be like this, which is 100. And half of the median is 50, and those who are considered below are considered to be failed. However, here it says that more than half is always passed and less than 1/4 is always failed, which is not possible. So a positional average cannot be compared with that of an absolute value, which is obtained from a maximum score. This is a median score and this is the maximum score. These two cannot be compared directly. So options 2 and 3 are also eliminated. Now it is possible that no one fails. This is one of the options, because when a student, see, when everybody scores 100, then it is possible that no one fails in spite of the presence of the region of this range. So it is possible that no one fails. Option 4 is the correct option. Next question. N is a 4-digit number. The leftmost digit is removed. The resulting 3-digit number is 1/9 of n. How many such n are possible? This is the question. N is a 4-digit number. Let it be A, B, C, D, where A is the 1000th place, B is in the 100th place, C is the 10th place, and D is the 1th place. So we can represent this number as 1000 A plus 100 into B plus 10 into C plus D. Here, each of these refer to. So here it implies that A, B, C and D are natural numbers, and their multiplication with these values respectively will result in a 4-digit number, which is n. It is seen that when the leftmost digit of the number is removed, that is when A is removed, B, C, D equals 1/9 of A, B, C, D. This is a given question. How many such n's are possible? So expanding this also in terms similar to this, 100b plus 10c plus d is 1/9 of 1000a plus 100b plus 10c plus d. Now 1000a, equating these options and cancelling the commons, we get 8 into 100b plus 10c plus d. That is 125a is 100b plus 10c plus d is the given value. So b, c, d is written in terms of a. It's a given thing. So now by substituting each of the values for a, we can find the values of b, c, d. So we know that b, c, d is a 3-digit number. A, b, c, d is a 4-digit number and b, c, d is a 3-digit number. So here we see that it can range from the value 0 to 999. Okay. Now, when we substitute A to be 0, the entire value becomes 0. But it is given that N is a 4-digit number. Therefore, A is not a correct option. Now, when A is 1, BCD is 125, which is a 3-digit number. Continuing so on and so forth, till A equal to 6, BCD is 750. Which is also a 3-digit number. When A equal to 7, BCD is 875, which is also true. When A is equal to 8, BCD becomes 1000. But BCD can only be a 3-digit number. So BCD cannot be 1000. So And any values beyond 8, when for A beyond 8, BCD value is going to be higher. So values from A equal to 1 to A equal to 7 are the values to which this value is correct. That is, are the values when BCD is a 3-digit number. So the number of possible number of ends that are possible are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So 7 such ends are possible in which the 3-digit number is 9 times that of the 4-digit number. So option 4 is the correct option. Thank you for watching.